everybody, it's Katrina. Oldest known work of art. If you thought the Lascaux cave paintings were the oldest works of art in the world, like most of us, then surprise! Scientists recently discovered a cave painting in Indonesia that's been dated back to approximately 44,000 years ago, which makes it the oldest known work of art on the planet. For years, most researchers believed that cave art began in Europe, since we have found most of the extensive examples in France and Spain dating back around 37,000 years. But archaeologists working in Indonesia were suspicious. And now that they've dated their cave paintings, their suspicions have been confirmed. Found in a cave on the island of Sulawesi, Indonesia, it is helping to rewrite the history of the origins of art. Using an inventive scientific dating technique called uranium series analysis, scientists from Griffith University in Australia were able to date these Indonesian cave paintings back to over 40,000 years ago. Locals had known about the paintings for years, but no one really assumed that they were that old. Revealed in 2017, now the search is on to find even more of these paintings. One of the most impressive is a hunting scene that stretches about 16 feet long, depicting a scene of ancient peoples on a hunt. Tiny hunters with spears appear to be chasing after wild pigs and buffalo. Strangely, however, these hunters have certain animal-like characteristics, like a bird's head on one or a tail on another. These images might suggest that these early people had spiritual or religious beliefs and conceptually advanced thinking. Our understanding of human history is constantly changing, and as the archaeologist said, there could be some big changes in store. Aztec sacrifices. Recently in 2019, archaeologists discovered sacred offerings on what was once an Aztec ritual platform. Their incredible find may finally lead to an Aztec emperor's tomb. So far, none have ever been uncovered. Off the steps of the Aztec's holiest temple, archaeologists found a large rectangular stone box in what would have been the center of a circular platform. They opened the mystery box with care and discovered a jaguar, ornately dressed as an Aztec warrior. Researchers found these new remains in the downtown area of Mexico City, which was once the location of the most revered temple in Aztec culture during the reign of the empire's most powerful ruler. Called the Templo Mayor, it was 15 stories high before it was razed to the ground in 1521, during the Spanish conquest. In addition to the jaguar dressed up like a warrior, they discovered the sacrificial remains of a child, dressed up as if he was the Aztec god of war. They also found some knives made out of flint, which were adorned with elaborate jewels and stones, along with the remains of a flamingo-like bird and a number of shells and coral. Records say that Aztec rulers were cremated and the remains were placed with luxurious offerings and the hearts of sacrificed slaves. It is possible that an emperor may be in the box, along with the jaguar, representing the king as a fearless warrior. The contents of the box were laid in their resting place by Aztec priests some 500 years ago. Reuters reported that since the find, the Mexican government has cut the project's budget and many of the archaeologists have not yet been paid. They are hoping to get back to work and to find the elusive remains of an emperor. Temple from a water cult. Researchers recently uncovered the remains of a temple from 3,000 years ago in Peru, which they think was used by a prehistoric cult of water for fertility ceremonies. This would place its construction square in the middle of the Stone Age. But interestingly, this discovery marks the first Stone Age temple discovery in the region. It was located in the Huaca el Toro archaeological site in Oyotun, Peru, nestled in between two rivers which are inside of the Zaña Valley, and it's the only one of its kind in the area. Even more interesting, perhaps, than the remoteness of this archaeological discovery is its intended purpose. Archaeologists think that this temple was the home of a prehistoric cult that worshipped water. That's why they constructed this space near the place where a new river comes into existence. The fact that it's placed in between these two rivers and the placement of tiny wells that could predict when it would rain indicate that water was essential to these people's way of life. The temple appears to have been made with big rocks which were transported from almost 2 miles away, where there was a nearby mountain. And although generations likely inhabited this space, it appears that people left there around 250 BC. However, the Chumi people later re-inhabited the site and used it as an area for tombs. However, they did find one tomb from the original inhabitant who was buried with a ceremonial ceramic container. Emperor Nero's Sphinx Room. In 2018, conservationists who were working on the restoration of Emperor Nero's palace in Rome found something completely unexpected, a secret underground chamber. Inside was a series of colorful animal frescoes, which depicted images of panthers, centaurs, and a sphinx. The palace, known as the Domus Aurea, was built more than 1900 years ago following the fire of 64 AD that destroyed large swaths of Rome. It was Nero's pride and joy, but hasn't stood the test of time so well. Efforts are underway to regain some of its former glory, and this new discovery further shows how enamored with art the emperor was. It's been nicknamed the Sphinx Room by workers because of one of the standout images, but there are also murals of flowers, leaves, fruit, aquatic creatures, exotic birds, and the god Pan. Unfortunately, the room is buried by tons of earth, and disturbing it could jeopardize the foundations upon which the rest of the palace is built. It'll therefore take quite some time until the full extent of what's in there is known, but investigations began in early 2019 and may one day reveal more secrets about one of Rome's most infamous emperors, who is believed to have been responsible for starting the fire in Rome so he could rebuild the city, as well as murdering his mother, both of his wives, and eventually committing suicide at the age of 30. Ancient humans in Idaho. In 2019, archaeologists uncovered the remnants of human activity from around 16,600 years ago, in Idaho no less. These discoveries shed new light on how humans must have traveled in prehistory, indicating where they went as they explored the Americas. They discovered these remnants at Cooper's Ferry, an archaeological digging site that's located around the Salmon River in Cottonwood, Idaho. The thoughts that these new artifacts provoke are certainly evocative. Via radiocarbon dating techniques, they've been dated back to a time when woolly mammoths and saber-toothed tigers roamed the icy expanses of North America. They uncovered a number of ancient artifacts, such as four tools which were intended to cut stone, bone fragments that belonged to horses, and evidence of a fire-building apparatus. And the dates on these new discoveries are the earliest evidence of human activity in the Americas. Given the age of humanity, this is a remarkable discovery. Archaeologists generally agree that humanity began some 300,000 years ago in the middle of Africa, and we then traveled the world far and wide setting up shop. No one is quite sure when humans came to the Americas, but the Cooper's Ferry findings lend credence to the theory that humans traveled the Pacific coast in order to reach America. There might even be a connection between the people at Cooper's Ferry and ancient human settlements in Asia. Scientists are working hard to piece together our ancient past. Romulus's tomb. Archaeologists recently discovered a tomb from millennia ago that the ancient Romans thought of as the burial chamber of Romulus, the mythical founder of Rome. While most researchers and historians don't think that Romulus ever actually existed, it's clear that the tomb was revered as if it was his. As the legend goes, Romulus, along with Remus, his twin, were the sons of Rhea Silvia and the god of war himself, Mars. They were abandoned and then raised by a she-wolf. When they were older, they restored their grandfather to power and built a city in the area where they were abandoned. But Romulus and Remus didn't agree on the location, so Romulus, or perhaps his supporters, killed Remus and he became the first king of Rome. His tomb was discovered below the Roman Forum. Apparently, ancient Romans believed that this tomb contained Romulus's body, but the tomb itself was empty when archaeologists found it. Instead, the tomb was a kind of temple that contained an altar in Romulus's memory. The historian Marcus Terentius Varro even wrote about it. It's also near the supposed place where Romulus was killed by jealous politicians, so the placement of the time is highly symbolic. Hopefully, over the coming months, we get to find out more about this fascinating site. The USS Nevada. We all know that Navy ships are durable and hard to sink, but there may be one ship among all of the Navy's fleet that stood above the rest for decades. The USS Nevada made it through World War II, even though it was built in 1912. It made it through a number of other insane trials and tribulations as well, surviving nuclear and ammunition tests. The USS Nevada sailed through difficult sections of the ocean. It was hit at Pearl Harbor, but made it back to fight through the war in 1943, and was going to be used even further before the war came to an end. Afterwards, it was used as a target for nuclear tests at Bikini Atoll. Surprisingly, it made it through. Finally, it was decommissioned and sunk in 1946 by an aerial torpedo. However, just a few months ago in 2020, a joint expedition run by Search Inc. and Ocean Infinity discovered the remains of the USS Nevada about 3 miles underwater, off the coast of Honolulu and near Pearl Harbor. The ship's husk shows signs of the shots and torpedoes that it experienced before it sunk, but remarkably, the outside of the ship still displayed its paint job and the number 36 could be seen at the head of the ship. The newly discovered wreckage serves as a monument to the USS Nevada's lasting power. Megalithic monument. When you hear about the Neolithic age, you probably think about the megalithic structures of Europe, which are pretty popular. But structures in Middle Eastern countries from the same period are less well known, even though they are equally impressive. In 2020, archaeologists added yet another one of these to the list, deep inside Dumat al-Jandal, an ancient oasis which contains a number of ruins in Saudi Arabia. They discovered a large triangular platform in the middle of nowhere. No one is yet sure as to the nature of this strange platform, but researchers think that it was probably used to some sort of ritualistic end. Built in a few steps around the 6th millennium BC, megalithic peoples might have used the platform for funeral purposes or to celebrate key astrological events. They think this because they determined the ages of the human remains that they found near the platform, as well as in the tombs they uncovered close by. These findings suggest that nomadic pastoralists might have made the platform. These people were early innovators with respect to agriculture and likely traveled far and wide according to the seasons. For a while, archaeologists thought that little groups of nomads couldn't have built big things like this, but that notion is slowly eroding. When they keep finding discoveries like this, it's hard to ignore that nomads might have been more capable of big projects than we previously thought. Temple of Nageswara Swami. Recently, villagers in a tiny Indian village unearthed a remarkable discovery, the remains of a well-preserved temple that had been lost to time since the 1850s. It was found in Perumalapadu, which is a village in the Nellore district of India. In about 1850 AD, the village was rendered unlivable because the nearby Penna River was rising and kept flooding the village. When everyone moved away, the sand dunes engulfed the temple whole. Elders told stories of a temple lost in the dunes, so people decided to go look for it. When the villagers got a bit of cabin fever due to the coronavirus lockdown, they opted to look for the temple which their elders had described to them. They were able to locate the brick temple, which is dedicated to Lord Nageswara, better known to the English-speaking world as Lord Shiva. Researchers estimate that the temple was built some 300 years ago, along with two other nearby temples. Much of the temple complex remains buried. Local legend has it that the temple itself was consecrated by Lord Parasurama, who is one of the 10 human incarnations of Lord Vishnu, the preserver and guardian of men who protects worldly order in the Hindu religion. To understand how important that is, note that Lord Krishna is also one of Lord Vishnu's human incarnations. There are still a lot of temples waiting to be unearthed in the region, so keep an eye out for future updates. Roman head in Mexico. This terracotta head was first uncovered in the Toluca Valley near Mexico City. Officially called the Tecahic-Calixtlahuaca head, try to say that three times fast, at first glance you might not think much of it. It's just a terracotta sculpture of a head, right? True, but experts are stumped because this head looks just like many artifacts made by the Romans. But how would a Roman artifact end up in a grave in Mexico? Excavated in 1933, the grave was found three floors below a pyramid along with offerings. Archaeologists found all kinds of precious stones, bones, shells, pottery, and other goodies dating back to the late 1400s. Among the artifacts was this strange head. The main archaeologist, José García Pellón, decided not to tell anyone about the Roman head, probably since other researchers would not take a discovery like that seriously. So while the grave was excavated in 1933, he didn't say anything until 1960. This then led to much debate about the origin of the terracotta head. Some experts think it's fake, but others support it. Could it have been imported from Europe? Could the Vikings have brought it? Or could the Romans have actually traveled to the Americas at some point? There are suspicions that the Romans may have traveled to the Americas, but there is very little evidence. In 2001, two researchers who were fascinated by the artifact decided to dig deeper to solve the mystery. The Roman head was confirmed authentic by specialists in Rome and dated it back to the 2nd century. However, there is very little information available about the context of the archaeological site in Mexico, so there is no way to tell the story of how it got there. We'll just have to wait and see if further information becomes available. Knightly sword with inscription. In 1825, archaeologists uncovered a sword from the River Witham in Lincolnshire, UK. This sword, pulled from the river, reminiscent of legend, had a strange inscription along the side made with gold inlay that reads something quite indecipherable. Dating back to the 13th century, to this day no one has been able to come up with a definitive translation of this strange message. You can go see the sword for yourself at the British Library. Through intensive archaeological analysis, experts have determined that the sword was probably constructed somewhere in Germany. The sword is made of steel with a hilt shaped like a cross, perhaps used during the Crusades. The language used to make the 18-letter word is unknown, but the British Museum is on the hunt to crack this elusive code, asking the public for help. Researchers from several universities have said that swords with these types of inscriptions were all the rage in 13th century Europe. Pre-Christian tribes used to inscribe runes onto their weapons to endow the item with magical powers, so it is possible the tradition continued into Christian times with inscriptions to call for protection during battle. But the inscription on this sword is still a mystery, and may have been extremely personal to the bearer of the sword and something quite obvious to him, and quite the enigma for us. Haumea. Haumea is a dwarf planet that orbits in the Kuiper Belt past Neptune. It is about the same size as Pluto and is one of the fastest rotating objects in our entire solar system. A day on Haumea lasts a mere 4 Earth hours, and it is rotating so fast that it's not really a perfect sphere. It's getting distorted and oblong, more like an American football than a soccer ball. It has 2 known moons, and besides all that, it has even more going on. You might think that Haumea couldn't get any weirder, but you'd be wrong. We just keep finding out more puzzling facts about it. In 2017, astronomers were observing Haumea and observed it pass in front of a star. When this happened, they saw something they'd never seen before. Haumea has rings around it. They still don't know how this happened, but the rings probably formed a long time ago when Haumea collided with something else. But it does make it the first confirmed object within the Kuiper Belt to have rings around it. The Kuiper Belt is a strange place, and knowing that Haumea is a part of it only makes it more intriguing. There are a ton of icy objects orbiting our sun in the Kuiper Belt, which has been around for some 4.5 billion years. Supposedly, it was one of the first things to form whenever our solar system came into being. These objects are often referred to as Plutoids. There are probably more of them, and scientists are keeping an eye out. Coventry Cubes. Just earlier this year, a man and his children went magnet fishing in the River Sow, which is in Coventry, England. Magnet fishing is an interesting pastime where one throws a magnet into a body of water and sees what they pull out. And this family's haul didn't disappoint. They unearthed around 60 incredibly detailed, tiny silver-colored lead cubes with numerical inscriptions. But no one knows how they got there. But since they were found, the internet has been on the hunt to uncover their original use. One Redditor saw these cubes and identified them as a fortune-telling token, often used with a type of Hindu prayer. The Hindus subscribe to a particular astrological picture of the world, where the planets in our universe are linked to elements on Earth. For the Hindus, lead is associated with Rahu, which is a part of the orbit of the moon. These cubes are inscribed with strange squares. It's like an ancient version of a Microsoft Excel document. This might correspond to the same kind of sacred geometry to find use in prayer. This indicates that they could have been used to summon up the power of Rahu for its protection. At one point, the father even returned to the site and found a silver coin in the same spot. However, no one is sure why these cubes and the coin were in the River Sow. Dating lead artifacts is hard, and these have yet to receive a satisfying analysis. So until more information comes out, we'll just have to wait and see. Gada. Have you ever seen a gada? It's kind of like a mixture between a mace and a mallet, although I'm not quite sure how I'd use one in battle. But it has a pretty rich history in Indian mythology, and because of that, there's actually many people in India who specialize in fighting with these weapons. For one thing, it's still used in silat, which is a particular kind of martial art that's practiced throughout different parts of Asia. But who used the gada in battle? In Indian mythology, the gada is the chief weapon wielded by the god Hanuman. Hanuman is one of the main characters from the epic Ramayana, but he features in many other places within Hindu mythology. In fact, Hanuman is worshipped all throughout the world by silat practitioners. In particular, wrestlers throughout southeastern Asia look to him for strength. But he's not the only one who carries a gada. In fact, Vishnu carried one, and it's named Kalmodaki. Due to its placement within the Hindu tradition, it's earned a role as one of the main pieces of training equipment that people within the religion use. Sometimes people hold one or two gada at a time and train themselves by swinging them before and behind them, which helps to increase the level of grip that one can endure. It's also a really good shoulder workout. So if you're looking for a meaningful addition to your workout routine, the gada might be for you. Volgograd discs. In 2015, a group of amateur investigators came upon a remarkable discovery in Volgograd, Russia, about a dozen gigantic stone disks that appeared to look like big, rocky UFOs. This discovery would be strange enough on its own if it weren't for what they claimed to find inside of the rocks, tungsten. Tungsten is one of the toughest naturally occurring metals, and because of that, the military uses it a lot in their technology. They have no idea where these discs came from or what they might have been used for. Of course, given their strange UFO-like shapes, conspiracy theorists have had a field day. Consider Scott Waring from the conspiracy outfit UFO Sightings Daily. He claims that these stones are definitive proof that aliens are out there. Why would this military metal be found in a stone that appears to have been made with clear, intelligent intent? Other UFO people have claimed that these stones are about 1 million years old. Perhaps they were used to attack Mars, but had to make a crash landing on Earth. These theories are fun, but unlikely. The stones are currently being studied by the folks at the Zhirinovsky Museum, where they hope to gain further information concerning these stones' age and constitution. They may not have even been made by humans at all. Erosion might have done the trick. It'll take more research to know for sure, but these stones are definitely evocative. Tabby's Star. Tabby's Star is perhaps the most mysterious star that humanity has ever discovered. Estimates place it at around 1,470 light-years away from our planet, and ever since we first discovered it, it's displayed strange behavior. The light emitted from the star fluctuates wildly, sometimes dimming its brightness up to 22%, and without any clear pattern. But to this day, there's still not an explanation that's received a satisfying scientific consensus. And when science fails, that's when people start invoking aliens. Some scientists initially suggested that orbiting planets could cause the dimming, but this would happen with regularity and wouldn't cause a 22% reduction. It also seems like the brightness has faded a little bit over time. So could it be aliens? Probably not. Certain wavelengths of light are more occluded than others, and that wouldn't happen if there were some sort of alien structure located on or around the star. This has led scientists to what they think is the best explanation. Large amounts of dust and comets orbiting the star, likely coming from exomoons. An exomoon is a chunk of debris from a planet that sheds large amounts of dust as it revolves around the star. It'll take a long time for the dust to evaporate completely, and it would probably happen with a great degree of irregularity. It could explain the long-term fading as well, but scientists still need more data to really confirm this hypothesis. Kensington Runestone. The Kensington Runestone is one of the most elusive archaeological artifacts in the world. It's a monster slab made out of greywacke, a type of rudimentary sandstone. Weighing in at around 202 pounds, this artifact was allegedly discovered by one Olaf Oman, an immigrant from Sweden, in 1898. He claimed that he found it in Solem, Minnesota, clutched in the roots of an aspen tree. The writing on the stone appears to indicate that there were Scandinavians present in the area sometime in the 1300s. Is it possible that Vikings could have been in the area at the time? The Runestone Museum, which houses this famous stone, says that the runestone has led researchers from around the world and across the centuries on an exhaustive quest to explain how a runic artifact dated 1362 could show up in North America. The artifact is definitely unusual. However, not everyone agrees as to its authenticity. To its endorsers, it's stunning confirmation that Vikings explored the Americas, but to others, it's just an old rock with some fake writing on it. For one thing, the story that the inscriptions tell doesn't seem all that credible. There is no record of an expedition, after all. Also, the runes on the stone might not be entirely legitimate. However, some analyses suggest the stone is indeed older than 200 years. However, there is one factor that doesn't seem to get a lot of attention. Olaf Oman, although from Scandinavia, wasn't an expert in Nordic runes or anything like that. He did have friends who might have known about ancient runes, but this has never been confirmed. And the debate rages on. Some people think that the runes are real, others think they are not. But it's been an enduring debate, and it doesn't seem like it's going to stop anytime soon. Valley of the Whales. Nicknamed the Valley of the Whales and oddly situated in the Egyptian desert, the Wadi al-Hitan archaeological site boasts a large collection of whale remains from the earliest and long-extinct suborder, Archaeoceti. These prehistoric whales, known under the species name Basilosaurus, flourished 37 million years ago during the Mesozoic era, when the Tethys Ocean existed between the ancient continents of Gondwana and Laurasia. Unlike modern whales, Basilosaurus had two small, perfectly developed but relatively useless hind legs protruding from its flanks. It did not use its legs for swimming, indicating that modern whales evolved from terrestrial animals, according to vertebrate paleontologist Philip Gingrich, who spoke with National Geographic. Gingrich has spent the better part of his career arguing in favor of this theory, which flies directly in the face of the long-held belief that whales represent a lack of evolution. He and his colleagues have discovered the remains of over 1,000 whales at Wadi al-Hitan over a 27-year span. According to Gingrich's theory, a common ancestor between whales and all other creatures, a salamander-like tetrapod, hoisted its body out of the water and onto land around 360 million years ago. Over time, its fins developed into legs, and its body adapted to life on land. But some of these creatures made their way back into the water and lost any reason to have legs, and their bodies readjusted to a marine habitat. This is considered an amazing feat among experts, so impressive in fact that they can't quite explain how it happened. Historically renowned scientists, including Charles Darwin and George Gaylord Simpson, are among the many who struggled to determine the whale's place on the evolutionary family tree. Gingrich has made remarkable strides throughout his career, identifying several previously unknown ancient cetaceans and whale ancestors and coming much closer to filling in the family tree gaps. But as discoveries like these often lead to a new set of questions, one thing is certain. It will take quite some time for scientists to fully untangle the animal kingdom's extraordinary past. Alien artifacts in Mexico. One night in 1999, Dr. Pablo Enrique Garcia Sanchez set up camp in the barren desert in the sparsely populated northeastern Mexican town of Ojuelos de Jalisco. During his stay, the man allegedly discovered a strange small rock covered in mysterious carvings, which seemed Mayan in origin to Garcia. This was highly unlikely, however, as the ancient Maya were known to have settled at least 1,000 miles away. Aztec trading routes, on the other hand, had extended pretty far north, indicating a possible source for the object. Locals told Garcia that they had been finding similar artifacts for over 80 years. Acting on rumors that a nearby cave contained hundreds more items, Garcia formed a research team called Nahui Oyin, or Fifth World, who supposedly cataloged over 400 items found throughout the area, including a helmet shaped like an alien's head. The clay and stone objects appeared to depict things like UFOs, aliens, humans in spacesuits, and scenes from outer space. For having gathered so many artifacts, Garcia's collection was suspiciously scarce by the time the academic community paid any attention to it. Critics believe that the items, which are commonly sold in the area, are fakes marketed to unsuspecting tourists. Even more strangely, internet searches turn up no verified credentials for Dr. Garcia, and no reputable websites seem to contain information about his so-called alien artifacts. It is very hard to explain Garcia's collection, and who or where he is. Unidentified big cat. In late 2019, Egypt's Ministry of Antiquities announced the discovery of extremely strange animal remains resembling a big cat. The creature was unearthed during excavations south of Cairo at Saqqara, an ancient town that was home to a vast burial ground and the famous Step Pyramid. While archaeologists believe the animal may be a lion or lioness, based on the ancient Egyptians' worship of felines, it looks enough out of the ordinary for them to be unsure, primarily due to its unusually large size. In an interview with Express UK, Egypt's Minister of Antiquities, Dr. Khaled El Anani, explained that the animal's species will be announced once it is identified through DNA testing and CT scans. Dr. El Anani credits the ministry's use of the most advanced archaeological technology available for this and other one-of-a-kind discoveries throughout Egypt in recent years. Many of these newly unearthed artifacts will feature in Cairo's yet unfinished Grand Egyptian Museum, or GEM, which Major General Atef Moftah recently promised will be completed by year's end. Originally scheduled to open in 2011, before apparently encountering several setbacks, the building will feature over 100,000 ancient Egyptian artifacts, making it the world's largest museum dedicated to a single civilization. Dorset hybrids. While excavating in Dorset County, England in 2015, archaeologists from Bournemouth University discovered Iron Age animal bones that were bizarrely rearranged to form mythical hybrid beasts. One cow, who was presumably sacrificed like others at the site, was situated with four horse legs, and there were several other examples of horses and cows having their bones interchanged. A two-headed sheep contained the head of a bull, protruding from its rear end, and a dog skeleton was fitted with three lower jaw bones from cows. The strangest discovery was that of a young woman's remains resting atop a bed of cattle, sheep, dog, and horse bones, with the animal's bones corresponding to whatever body part of hers laid over them. Her skeleton bore evidence of her also having been sacrificed. Stories about strangely blended creatures were a known part of several ancient Mediterranean cultures, including the Greeks, Mesopotamians, and Egyptians. Prior to this seemingly rather out-of-place discovery, however, such myths were not known to play any role in Britain's ancient Celtic population. Archaeologist and excavation co-director Dr. Miles Russell said that the sacrifice of so many animals and the unusual treatment of their bones is likely to shed totally new light on Iron Age belief systems, and may suggest that the ancient Britons had beliefs or mythologies which involved hybridized animals, just like the ancient Greeks. The bones were found at a settlement that once contained 150 to 200 houses, which was likely occupied by early members of the ancient Durotrigs tribe just a few generations before Rome conquered Britain. Flint funerary objects. While excavating a cemetery at the Karaysin archaeological site in Jordan, a team of Spanish archaeologists recently unearthed over 100 violin-shaped flint objects dating back around 10,000 years. Their findings, published in the journal Antiquity, claim that the artifacts may represent the earliest known examples of figurative art in the Middle East. The flint items are unlike any stone tools or weapons at the site, bearing no signs of wear and lacking sharp edges, archaeologist Juan José Ibáñez told New Scientist. Ibáñez and his colleagues hypothesized that the objects were possibly manufactured and discarded during funeral ceremonies involving the extraction, manipulation, and reburial of human remains. Ranging in size from 0.4 to 2 inches, the artifacts vaguely resemble the human form, according to the researchers, who mentioned the possible use of the items to express beliefs and feelings and to show their attachment to the deceased, in the words of co-author Farron Borrell, who spoke with Zenger News. While the team believes that all signs point toward these conclusions, some experts remain unconvinced, citing the human tendency to detect human-like features when we want to. In other words, to see what we want to see, even in the absence of a reliable basis for doing so. Whale and cannonball. While conducting preliminary excavations ahead of the construction of a new light rail system in the Edinburgh, Scotland port town of Leith, archaeologists unearthed a strange array of artifacts, including an iron cannonball, the remains of what may have been a 16th or 17th century seawall, and a pair of bones belonging to a deceased male sperm whale. Discovered in late 2019, the matching radius and ulna are thought to be as much as 800 years old, possibly dating back to the medieval era, although experts were still awaiting radiocarbon dating results when news broke of the find. Once a whaling town, Leith was settled around that time, suggesting that a whale hunter may have brought the bones ashore as a trophy, although they would have been strange body parts to keep, according to Edinburgh Council archaeologist John Lawson, who admits that how the remains ended up at the site is a mystery. It's also possible that the whale beached itself nearby and somehow ended up at its final resting place. Leith's whaling history dates back to the Middle Ages, with the industry peaking between the early 17th and 20th centuries. Consequently, learning the age of the bones will help guide researchers toward more sound theories regarding how and why they ended up buried in the town. Ancient demonic drawing. While examining a 2,700-year-old Assyrian clay tablet earlier this year at a museum in Berlin, Assyriologist Troels Pank Arbol noticed a disturbing depiction of a demon with horns, a tail, and a forked tongue. Arbol was the first researcher to notice the 2.5-inch inscription, despite the artifact having been discovered decades earlier. The tablet, which was likely copied from a much earlier text, belonged to the private library of Kisir Ashur, a man who lived in Assur, an ancient city that was located in what's now northern Iraq, around 650 BC. Written in cuneiform, it contained remedies for a condition the Assyrians called Bennu, which entailed epilepsy-like symptoms such as convulsions and involuntary movements and twitches. Modern medicine has come a long way since then. The Assyrians believed that demonic possession caused Bennu, which perhaps explains the devilish drawing Arbol noticed on the tablet. His months-long analysis of the barely noticeable image culminated into a study, in which he theorizes that the ancient society believed that the epilepsy-inflicting demon acts on behalf of Sin, the Mesopotamian moon god. While it was not unusual for the Assyrians to take a two-pronged approach to health problems, using both magic and medicine, drawings on cuneiform tablets are rare, demonic drawings even more so. And although the inscription has been properly identified, the motivations behind whoever created it remain somewhat obscure. The most likely explanation, in Arbol's words, is that the demon appears as the healer who wrote the text must have imagined it. Inca offering. Straddling the border between Peru and Bolivia, Lake Titicaca was a sacred site to the Inca Empire. As the site of the civilization's creation story, the Isla del Sol, or Island of the Sun, situated in the lower part of the lake, was home to over 80 temples and other ritual-related structures throughout the Inca's heyday. A recently published study details how an international team of archaeologists recovered an andesite offering box on the lake's bottom, roughly 18 feet below the water's surface. Estimated to be at least 5 centuries old, the box measures around 14 by 10 by 6.5 inches and has an offering cavity accompanied by a stone plug. Inside was a llama figurine made from spondylus, the rare and valuable coral-colored shell of a spiny oyster, as well as a small rolled cylinder of gold sheeting. Researchers believe that the gold roll represents a chipana, a bracelet that Inca noblemen wore. Treasure hunters scavenged Lake Titicaca long before archaeologists arrived there, making the find an especially rare and valuable one. Altogether, parts from over 24 offering boxes have been discovered. Researchers believe the offerings had various meanings, ranging from political statements to farm-related requests, co-author Christophe Dallaire told National Geographic in an email, and the specific meaning of the recently discovered box's contents is unknown. Offering boxes allegedly sometimes contained the blood of children and animals, according to 17th-century cleric Alonso Ramos Gavilan, who recorded claims that as the boxes were lowered into the lake, the blood turned the surrounding water red. Residue analyses and other testing will hopefully reveal more about these cryptic artifacts, which experts can only speculate about for the time being. Number 1. Egyptian Mystery Woman. In 2017, archaeologists working along the west bank of the Nile at Dahshur, a royal ancient Egyptian necropolis, discovered the foundations of a 13th-century pyramid. They continued to dig until they reached the burial chamber, where they found wood fragments, which pieced together to form a coffin lid depicting a beautifully carved female face. Much to the surprise of experts, including Egyptologist Dr. Yasmin El-Shazly, the entombed individual was not a king, but a mystery woman. A chest in her burial chamber bearing hieroglyphics may help lead researchers to her identity, but for now, the mummified woman is a complete stranger to them. There are some clues, however. What's really important about this chest is that we know it belonged to a princess because here it says, "Daughter of the King," and then it would be followed by the name, Dr. El-Shazly said in Mystery of the Lost Pyramid, a Smithsonian documentary released earlier this year. But the name is the most damaged area, which is very frustrating. The ancient Egyptians believed that the worst thing you could possibly do to anyone was to erase their name. The woman's unknown identity is not the only mystifying thing about the pyramid, as Professor Aidan Dodson explained. This kind of pyramid design is specific to a king. It's not what you'd expect a junior member of the royal family to be in. Tomb and a chamber at the bottom of it, which makes the whole thing a real mystery. Dinosaur-like sea creature. While fishing for blue halibut in the North Sea in September 2019, fishing guide Oscar Lundahl caught an alien-like specimen with large, bulbous eyes, unlike any marine creature he had ever seen. The young man caught the strange fish off the northern Norwegian island of Andøya, where he had 4 hooks on his line. "It took me about 30 minutes to reel it in because it was over 2,600 feet deep," Lundahl told The Sun. When he saw his catch, which was captured along with 2 blue halibut, he nearly jumped out of his fishing boat. Lundahl did not know what the creature was, but someone he was fishing with did. According to The Sun and a post Lundahl made on Instagram, the fish was a Macrorus burglax, more commonly known as a rough-head grenadier or onion-eyed grenadier. The unfortunate fish did not survive the sudden pressure change it endured while being pulled from the dark depths of the sea, so Lundahl cooked and ate it. "Despite its ugly appearance, it was really tasty," he said. "It is a bit like cod, but tastier. Would you have eaten it? Let me know in the comments below." Orange tentacled alien. While fishing for halibut with friends and family off Prince of Wales Island in Alaska in August 2018, one angler reeled in a bizarre orange sea creature while her daughter, a woman named Sarah Vassar Alford, filmed footage of the specimen that went viral on social media. Shocked viewers described the being as strange and alien, with some even likening it to a horror movie scene. But no amount of adjectives can truly capture how weird this marine specimen was. It had a tiny orange body with long, curly tentacles, extending them in rhythm with its body in Vassar Alford's viral video, which amassed over 1.2 million viewers within weeks of being posted. Even more strangely, the creature's underside bore a series of blood vessel-like markings. Some concerned virtual onlookers speculated about what the life form was, with someone suggesting that it was a live coral, while others urged the person who caught the mysterious specimen to release it back into the ocean, which Vassar Alford reassured that's what she did. As it turns out, the creature was a basket star. Found in cold water deep-sea habitats worldwide, basket stars grow up to 3 feet long and are distantly related to starfish. They use their long, twirling appendages for moving along the sea floor and to grasp onto prey, such as krill or small crustaceans, before lowering the catch to their mouth and digging in. Swimming in the sea, they look beautiful, but all curled up and twirling might be a little creepy. Prehistoric-looking mud dweller. Early last year, an Australian fisherman named Andrew Rose and his friend T. Hogan caught a rare eel-like fish with no eyes and sharp teeth while fishing in the Northern Territory's Kakadu National Park. It was the first thing to bite after 6 hours of no luck while fishing for barramundi. The 6-inch specimen looked prehistoric, Rose said. It looked like something you see in the movies. Social media users compared the creature's appearance to a fictional alien species, the Xenomorph, which was featured in the 1979 sci-fi horror film Alien. Fish expert Dr. Michael Hammer from the Museum and Art Gallery of the Northern Territory clarified that the creepy animal was likely a worm goby. They have no eyes and live their life under the mud and are pretty rarely seen by people, Hammer explained. Hailing from the Taenioides genus, the fish is native to Australia's Northern Territory and it's harmless to humans, for the most part, despite its off-putting appearance. How did he fish it out of the sea? It's not all that exciting, to be honest, Rose told ABC News. The technique was holding a beer and rod at the same time. But remember to let us know which catch you think was the creepiest in the comments below. And subscribe if you haven't already to join the Origins Explained family. Lancet fish. Lancet fish were once seldom seen or captured by humans, and encounters were only likely to happen if one washed ashore. Yet in recent years, fisheries have increasingly caught lancet fish on long lines, making them one of the most frequently captured fish in some regions, including certain areas off the Hawaiian coast, where fishermen often catch more of them than big-eye tuna or swordfish, their primary targets. With a tall sail fin and sharp fangs, the little-known species lurks throughout an oceanic region where the sun's rays barely reach and the water is nearly pitch black. Lancet fish reach roughly 6 feet long, and between their gelatinous flesh, unpalatable taste, and the difficulty of housing them in aquariums, most fishermen simply toss them back into the ocean when they unintentionally reel one in. Not surprisingly, scientists know very little about the biology and behavior of lancet fish. Researchers from NOAA Pacific Islands Fisheries Science Center are collaborating with colleagues from the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute, Stanford University, and the University of Hawaii to learn more about the species, namely because they believe the fish can teach them more about the middle of the marine food web, according to the NOAA website. By studying the most undigested stomach contents of lancet fish, these experts catch a rare glimpse into the ecosystem in the region where these creatures dwell, offering insight into what many of the fish that we eat, like tuna, swordfish, and more, are eating. Poisonous fireworm. While fishing with her mother at a Port Isabel, Texas pier earlier this year, Alyssa Ramirez reeled in a 3-inch-long, bright, fuzzy creature that she knew, based on looks alone, to stay away from. At first, she thought seaweed had gotten tangled in her line, only to notice that the unidentified mass was squirming. Thankfully, Ramirez did not touch whatever it was, which turned out to be a bearded fireworm, a marine bristleworm known for its painful sting, according to the Texas Parks and Wildlife Department. "The bright colors gave me a sign not to touch it," Ramirez told My San Antonio. Loaded with neurotoxins, the worm's bristles are capable of causing nausea, dizziness, and a wound that feels like it's on fire. The pain is known to persist for hours. When disturbed, a bearded fireworm will flare out its bristles, which is exactly what one did during its encounter with Ramirez. The quick-thinking woman placed the creature at the edge of the pier, where it reportedly wiggled around for several minutes before falling into the water. Giant sea cockroach. In 2018, a team of researchers from the National University of Singapore, led by Peter Ng, discovered a terrifying 14-legged isopod while conducting a deep-sea survey off western Java, Indonesia. during which they collected 12,000 marine specimens. Nicknamed the Darth Vader sea cockroach, the never-before-seen creature was officially named Bathynomus raxasa. It's a species of giant isopod, meaning that while it looks more like a terrestrial woodlouse or a cockroach, this species is more closely related to crabs and shrimp. Bathynomus raxasa can reach up to 20 inches long, vastly exceeding most marine isopods, which grow to an average length of 13 inches, and classifying it as a supergiant among these creatures. It's the second largest known isopod, superseded only by B. giganteus, and owes its unusually large size to its cold, deep habitat, as well as the lack of predators it faces. B. raxasa lives on the seabed and scavenges for the remains of dead marine animals and can survive long periods without eating. It was found at a depth somewhere between 2,625 and 6,900 feet and serves as a testament to Indonesia's untapped marine biodiversity. Mystery Antarctic Fish. While exploring the depths beneath Antarctica in 2019, scientists discovered a strange new fish species that stood out against several other unidentified creatures that they came across during the expedition. Holding the small, mucus-like fish, lead scientist Dr. Andrew Stewart took on an almost perplexed tone. "Now, I have no idea what species this is," he said in a documentary posted to the YouTube channel Trax. "The color patterns on the fins is like nothing I've ever seen before." The new species is a type of snailfish, which encompasses over 400 species of gelatinous, rubbery, transparent fish. It's the latest in what's expected to be an ongoing series of snailfish discoveries throughout the world in coming years. The waters surrounding Antarctica were largely unexplored until recent years, making it no surprise, in one sense, that Dr. Stewart and his team discovered new species. Given the harsh environment they managed to survive in, however, these animals are nonetheless fascinating. These are the ice fish. Temperatures above 5 degrees is too hot for them, Dr. Stewart explained. That's why I came to Antarctica, to see things like this. It's beyond words. Coney Island creature. As if Brooklyn's iconic amusement park, Coney Island, wasn't already full of sideshows, things took an impromptu turn in the neighborhood earlier this year when someone fishing at the pier caught an odd-looking specimen that nobody could identify. It was grayish-colored with a gaping mouth and one long tentacle accompanied by two shorter appendages. TikTok user Natalia Vorobok posted footage of the disturbing creature flopping around, catapulting social media users into a panicked frenzy as they tried figuring out what the animal was. Unilad reached out to experts from the nonprofit Ocean Conservation Trust, who speculated along the same lines of many stunned viewers, suggesting that the creature was some kind of elasmobranch, in other words, a cartilaginous fish, perhaps a shark, ray, or a skate. In a statement to Unilad, marine animal expert Marcus Williams said, "From what we can see, it does appear to be an underdeveloped skate." Online speculators suggested that the animal might be a clear-nose skate, perhaps one who had folded themselves up in response to a perceived threat. This is entirely possible, as the species is found along the Atlantic from Massachusetts to South Florida. As far as the specimen captured in Coney Island goes, its fate remains unknown. Human-like haul. "Her lips are hotter than mine." This is the caption a Malaysian fisherman and Twitter user used in early July when posting a photo of a fish with an eerily human-like set of teeth. The creature's mouth prompted numerous social media users to speculate, or at least wonder, about the image of what looked like a triggerfish possibly being fake. In fact, one expert, marine ecologist David Booth, hopped on the bandwagon with this theory, saying that a triggerfish's teeth are large but not human-like, and accusing the images of being doctored. But to others, all signs point toward the fish being a real triggerfish, known to crunch crabs and other hard-shelled creatures with its shockingly human-like teeth. There are 40 triggerfish species worldwide, and although their appearance may surprise most people, divers and aquarium experts are more than familiar with these bottom-dwelling creatures. Whether or not the image was created by a trickster remains unclear. Two-mouthed fish. While many, if not most, strange marine creatures are discovered out at sea, every now and then a bizarre specimen appears in a lake, pond, or other water body. Take, for example, an upstate New York woman named Debbie Geddes, who reeled in what appeared to be a fish with two mouths last year out on Lake Champlain. When she felt something bite, Geddes became hopeful. "I actually commented, 'I hope it's as big as it feels,'" the Plattsburgh resident told Fox News. "When we got it in the boat, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Two mouths! And yet this fish was healthy and thriving." After capturing a few photos of the fish, Geddes released it back into the lake. Much to her surprise, the pictures went viral on social media, earning thousands of likes and shares within a short time after being posted. Social media users debated over what may have caused the fish's double-mouthed deformation, with Getz suggesting that a previous injury, perhaps from another fisher, was to blame. Others blamed pollution, citing Lake Champlain's long-standing ill reputation for more or less being a sewage dump. Regardless of what caused the fish's ailment, it was a memorable catch for Getz, who ultimately decided to toss the 6 to 7 pound specimen back into the lake. Platypus-like chimera. A fisherman named Gary Goodyear from the town of Templeman in Newfoundland and Labrador, Canada, recently hauled in a shocking creature while fishing on the Grand Banks of Newfoundland. Goodyear's net extended more than 2,625 feet deep before pulling up a specimen that the man didn't recognize. "I said, 'Good God, what in the heck is that?' Goodyear told CBS News. 'I've never seen nothing like that before.' The man went to grab the fish, measuring nearly 3.3 feet long, but reportedly didn't know what to do with it, leaving him and his crew to speculate about what exactly the dead animal was. "I thought it was a platypus because he had that big snout on it," Goodyear remarked. "It looked like he had wings, and his nose was, it was almost like rubber. I guess it was like cartilage." After failing to identify the fish among his crew and other acquaintances, the mystified fisherman took to Facebook for help. Soon enough, the creature was identified as a long-nosed chimera, which possessed a venom-filled spine that Goodyear and his friends were unaware of as they handled the creature with their bare hands. The deep-water species, which lives between 656 and 3,280 feet underwater, is rarely witnessed by humans, according to marine biologist Carolyn Meary from the Newfoundland and Labrador Department of Fisheries and Oceans. Owing to its deep-water habitat, scientists know very little about the long-nosed chimera's biology, behavior, and history, Meary pointed out, adding that the one captured by Goodyear likely died from the pressure change associated with ascending to the water's surface. She added that the fishermen were lucky the fish died on its way up, as an alive and well specimen may have opted to inflict injury with its long, sharp, poisonous spine. Thanks for watching! Do you like to go fishing? What's the weirdest thing you found in the water? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to hit that subscribe button, and I'll see you next time. Bye!